أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى سيدنا محمد صلاة دائمة مستمرة تدوم بدوامك وتبقى ببقائك وتخلط بخلودك صلاة لا غاية لها دون مرضاتك ولا جزاء لقائلها ومصليها غير جنتك والنظر إلى وجهك الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أومن كان ميتا فأحييناه وجعلنا له نورا يمشي به في الناس كمن مثله في الظلمات ليس بخارج منها اللہ سبحانہ و تعالی says in the قرآن کریم that do you think that a person who was dead and we gave him life and then we gave him a nur, a light, and now he walks among people with this nur, do you think this person is equal to the one who is wandering in the darkness? And he says, Ala inna awliya Allah la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. Remember that God's friends, His awliya, they have no fear and they are not grieved. And he says, Man yahdillahu fahuwa al-muhtad wa man yudlil falan tajida lahu waliyan murshida. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides someone, then he is guided. But if he wants to misguide him, then you will see that that misguided person has no wali and has no murshid. He has no guide and he has no teacher. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Al-ulama'u warathatul anbiya lam yurithu dinaram wala dirhaman innama warathul ilm. That the ulama and scholars of my ummah, they are the heirs of Prophet. They inherit prophets. And prophets do not leave behind dinar or dirham. Innama warathul ilm. Their legacy is a knowledge. وَمَنْ أَخَذَ بِهِ أَخَذَ بِحَذِّ الْوَافِرِينَ. And if one receives this knowledge, he is a man of enormous fortune. And he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, علماء أمتي كأنبياء بني إسرائيل. The status of the learned of my ummah, the scholar of my ummah, is like the prophets of Bani Israel. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man aada li waliyan, faqad aadantuhu bil harb." If one has hostility, animosity towards my wali, towards my friend, then I declare my war against him. And he said, "Man adalla li waliyan, faqad istahalla maharabati." If one insults my wali and my friend, then he has justified me to wage a war against that person. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we are living in an age of enormous confusions. Confusions over those issues which used to be absolutely clear, that Muslim Ummah never had any disagreement on them. As Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, that a time will come that fitna will fall like the drops of rain. That one fitna is followed by another fitna, and people will be unable to make sense of what is happening to them. Of course, if we had been living few hundred years back in history, we would have not been confused on these issues. Shaykh Muhyiddin ibn Arabi rahimahullah 600 years ago wrote a book, Ruhul Qudus, and he was living in a very small town in modern day Spain, in Seville and Murcia, and he wrote small introduction of 500 Auliya who used to live in his town, in that one small town, and he visited them and studied under them, and they included men and women both. If we look in our own time, we will see that during the age of our parents and our grandparents, you will hardly find anyone who does not belong to some kind of spiritual silsila and does not have a shaykh, does not have a teacher whom he considered an authority, whom he considered a learned man that he will go and seek his help and guidance. But unfortunately, in recent history of Islam, we are facing a very rapid social change. We have the rise of sects which are misguided. We have the rise of sectarianism, that because of that, people, instead of looking at the issues from the point of view of Quran and Sunnah and the authentic teachings of ulama, they think in very narrow sectarian ways and deny and reject something which they think that it does not belong to their sect and their denomination. In this age of materialism, there is also decline in Ruhaniyya. And also another important factor which has created problem is the enormous fraud and corruption which has taken place in the realm of the tasawwuf, in the realm of spirituality, which makes very difficult to see that where is the truth. In Sahih al-Muslim, Imam Ibn Sirin rahimahullah's statement, which is quoted by Imam Muslim, it says, "Inna hadha al-'ilma deenun fanzuru mimman ta'khuzuna deenakum." That remember that this knowledge is your religion. This knowledge is not economics, it's not sociology, it's not political science. This knowledge is your religion. Be extremely careful from whom you receive this religion. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Wali and Murid are not the concepts which Sufis invented. These are the concepts which are present in the text of Quran, and they are present in many ahadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wali is a person who, because of his virtue, his piety, and his selection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is situated at a very higher place near, in the station of nearness and qurb of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And murid is a person who honestly and sincerely seeks the pleasure and rida of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Quran says, "Wasbir nafsaka ma'allazina yad'una rabbahum bilghadati wal'ashiyye yuriduna wajhahu." That, O believer, be steadfast and comfort yourself in the company of those who remember their Lord in mornings and evenings. Yuriduna wajhahu, they are seeking, they are doing irada of reaching to the divine face. And that is from where the word murid comes. Yuriduna wajhahu. Murid is not simply who kisses the hands and feet of his shaykh, which is also good and permissible. But he is in fact a person who has decided, he has chosen to pursue the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There was a great saint in Morocco in last century. He died in 1940, Sheikh Alawi rahimahullah. And that was the time of French colonialism, that it was, Morocco was occupied by French. But his spiritual power and his spiritual charisma was such that many French army generals, many French physicians, and many French administrators will go and visit his company and sit there. Many of them became Muslim, and in fact they went back to France, and there they created many Sufi circles, and in fact they translated enormous Sufi books into French language. So someone asked Sheikh Alawi, and one of his students, Martin Ling, who recently died, was a very great scholar of Islam. His book on Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's life, Muhammad on the basis of early sources, is the greatest and best seerah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in English. And he says, and he wrote the biography of his saint also, which is titled Sheikh Alawi, a saint of 20th century. And he says that one day someone asked Sheikh, that Sheikh, how come these Europeans come to you and they do not go to anybody else? And he said, Sheikh Alawi says, that my dear friend, they do not come to me, they are seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that khayarukum allazina idha zukira Allah. When a sahabi asked that, O Prophet, who are the people we should go and sit in their company? And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered that, go and sit in the company of a person that if you see him, you will remember God. If you see him, you will remember God. So the wali is the one who brings a person to God. He does not bring it to his own self. If he brings him to his own self, then he is not serving God, he is serving his own self. So dear brothers and sisters in Islam, what happens that it is the law of nature and it is the reality of life that anything which is very expensive and anything which is most valuable, that thing has also many fake and bogus representations. The higher and valuable something is, the greatest number of imitation, fake imitation will be. If you have a gold, there will be fake gold. If you have diamond, there will be fake diamonds. If you have a purse and shoes, which are from very expensive store, you will see that people are also selling their fake and bogus copies. Okay. Nobody will make copy of dirt. Nobody will sell fake copper, but people will sell you fake gold. And since Wilaya and the sainthood is the greatest thing which exists on this earth, there is nothing more valuable, there is nothing more higher than this, it has also its many fake and bogus versions. And that is which drives many people away from something which is very authentic and which is very genuine and which is an integral part of Islam and our deen. Auliya and saints of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are sometimes open, they are known, sometimes they are invisible, sometimes they are not known. They were known in history, they were unknown in history also. But in our age and time in particular, most of Auliya are invisible. And they are not publicly known. And the reason for that is that in our age and time, the respect of ulama, the dignity of ulama, the obedience of ulama has disappeared. You will see that an ordinary person, an absolutely jahil person, who doesn't know anything about Islam, he will stand up and he will tell a alim and scholar, you don't know. He will tell him, this hadith is zaif. And the person does not even know what is hadith in Islam. He does not know which hadith is called sa'if, according to the ulama of hadith. But you will find, and I experienced that a person will stand up and a hadith which is present in Bukhari, which is present in Muslim, which is present in Musnad Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, he will stand up and he will say, brother, this hadith is za'if. And the person is a computer technician. He never studied religion in any school, in any madrasa, in any university, never sat in front of a alim, and he stands up and questions and insults the people who are the people of knowledge, the people of wisdom, the people who have given their life to study these sciences. So since this is the age of rebellion, this is the age of rebellion, the age of insult, the age in which the dignity of ulama and awliya have disappeared, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to reveal the identity of his awliya. Because he does not want that his awliya should be insulted. Nobody wants to give his beloved to the dogs. Nobody wants that. And God does not want that. And it is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he hides them. Because if a person is known that he is God's wali, and then if he is insulted, then God will not forgive that person. God will not forgive that person. There is a hadith. Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, one day he went to the mosque of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he found that Hazrat Muaz ibn Jabal, he is sitting on the tomb of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he is crying. فوجد معاذ عند قبر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يبكي فقال ما يبكيك يا معاذ. Hazrat Umar says that, oh Muaz, what makes you cry? Okay. Now here you should also think that Sahaba go to the tomb of Prophet and cry because they know that there is someone there who will console and comfort their grief. Yeah. So Hazrat Umar asks him that, Muaz, why do you cry? And he says, I'm crying because of this hadith which I heard from Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Prophet said, Al yasiru min al riya'i shirkun, that the smallest amount of riya and show off, it is shirk. The smallest amount of riya is shirk. What does it mean? It means that an act which belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that act must be sincerely devoted to Him. So if a person wants to get respect, wants people's appreciation, wants people money in reward of that act, then it means that he has shared what was only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the meaning of hidden shirk, a secret shirk which we may not recognize. And he says that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَمَنْ عَادَى أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ بَارَزَ اللَّهُ بِالْمُحَارَمَةِ, that if a person has hostility, animosity towards God's friend, then he is inviting God to wage war against them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْأَبْرَارَ الْأَتْقِيَاءَ الْأَخْفِيَاءَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves His people, His virtuous and pious people, that they are invisible. They are not seen. الَّذِينَ إِذَا غَابُوا لَمْ يُفْتَقَدُوا. If they are absent, nobody will notice their absence. وَإِنْ حَضَرُوا لَمْ يُعْرَفُوا. And if they are present, nobody will recognize them. Nobody will call them, please come to the stage and sit here. قلوبهم مصابيح الدجا يخرجون من كل غبراء مظلمة. But these are the people that their hearts are lamp of light, the noor of guidance is in their heart. These people will come out from every dark test and of every dark which is darkness which is going on. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Islam and religion can be defined in many ways, but in one way that Quran Kareem has also defined this religion is that it says that this is a path. That the religion is defined as a path on which a person travels, a person on which journeys on that path. And Quran says that at the end of this path is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. وَإِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَىٰ. Therefore, a salik means a person who walks. Salak, walks. Salik is a person who walks on a path which leads him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And wali is a person who has traveled that path and he has reached in the proximity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Quran Kareem, in fact, never defines this religion of Quran and Sunnah. Quran and Sunnah are, of course, the foundation of our religion. These are the scriptures, these are the text, and these are the authorities. But Quran Kareem never defines this religion as the religion of Quran and Sunnah. It always defines that it is a path on which pious and virtuous people walk. So when in Surah Al-Fatiha, we pray and we say that, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you guide us to the straight path. Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. Now what is this straight path? Quran does not say, go to the path of Quran and Sunnah. It doesn't say that. It says, sirat al-ladhina anhamta alayhim. That find the path of those whom God blessed. That is the straight path. The straight path is the path on which God's blessed people, God's chosen people, God's virtuous people, that they have walked on that path. And if you can find that path, then you can be certain that you are on a straight path. Because that is what Sirat al-Mustaqim is. Inna hazihi tazkiratun. This Quran, this religion is a reminder. Faman sha'a attakhaza ila rabbihi sabila. Anyone who wants to take a path to his Lord, he should take this path. So if Sirat is path, Sabil is also a path. Then take a path. وَأَلَّا بِاسْتَقَامُوا عَلَى الطَّرِيقَةِ لَأَسْقَيْنَاهُمْ مَاءً غَدَقًا. Tariqa is path. Sufiya call their silsila tariqa, which is path. If they have been steadfast on this tariqa, we would have soaked them in our water. اگر وہ اس طریقے پر قائم رہتے اور اس پر استقامت رکھتے تو ہم انہیں سحراب کر دیتے. لَأَسْقَيْنَاهُمْ مَاءً غَدَقًا. That is the blessing of being in the path. That the path will soak you in this water, which is the divine water. Now, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, when we face this age of confusion, this age of doubt, where basic issues are muddled and the clarity has disappeared. And we have people from Osama bin Laden to Irshad Manji and Amina Wadood, everybody is trying to tell us this is Islam, this is Islam, this is Islam. How do you know whose Islam is true? Which Islam is right? Here, one of the important problems and the difficulty we have is that we do not understand the nature and structure of our religion. Because every knowledge, it has a structure. It has a framework in which you understand different things. You do not put biology in economics. and take an economic theory and put it in psychology. Every religion has a structure. And here, Prophet ﷺ himself gave us a structure to understand religion. And I have given many khutbas on that concept, which is based on the famous hadith of Prophet ﷺ, which is called Hadith Jibreel or Hadith Ihsan. Without going in detail, as you know, that Prophet ﷺ was sitting when this person comes and asks Prophet a question. And Sahaba do not know who this person is. And when Prophet answered, he says, O Prophet, you have spoken truth. And Sahaba are surprised that who is this person who is questioning Prophet, and then he is confirming that Prophet's statement is right. And he asked three questions, and then he asked about the end of time. Asked the third question. His first question is about Amal, which is Islam. And where Prophet ﷺ defines what a believer is supposed to do. His second question is about faith and iman, where Prophet ﷺ defined what a believer must believe. His third question is about ihsan, which means spiritual excellence. And where Prophet ﷺ says, Al-ihsanu an ta'budullaha ka annaka tarahu fa in lam takun tarahu fa innahu yarak. That spiritual excellence is that you worship God as you see Him. And if you do not see Him, then you know He sees you. Okay? And here in the station of Ihsan, Prophet ﷺ did not mention what a person is supposed to do, and he did not mention what a person is supposed to believe. The only thing he mentioned is what is the inner state of that believer. What is his inner self? And then he asked about the end time, and Prophet ﷺ said, "Mal mas'ulu minha bi'alamu min as-sa'il," that the person who is asking, he knows as much as the one whom he is asking. Okay? So Prophet did not say, "I do not know." Okay? These are people who interpret. Prophet could have said, I don't know. But he did not say that. He simply said, "I know as much as you know." Now, if anyone concludes from that Prophet did not know ghaib and unseen, then he is wrong. Because in the next question, when he asks, what are the signs which take place before the end time, Prophet ﷺ starts telling those signs immediately. And these signs are also ghaib. They are also ghaib. They are not there. Okay? However, and when the person leaves, Prophet ﷺ asks Hazrat Umar, go and see where does he go. And when Hazrat Umar goes after him, he suddenly disappears. And then Prophet smiles and he says, Innahu Jibreel Ataakum Yuallimukum Deenuk. That he was Jibreel and he came to teach you your religion. Now this statement of Prophet ﷺ, that he came to teach you your religion, ulama understood that this hadith has something to do how religion should be taught. So the knowledge of religion, the ilm of this religion must be based on this hadith. And in fact, ulama said that a person should sit in front of a alim as Jibreel sat in front of Prophet. Because that adab is part of learning. If you do not have that adab, then you will not learn. Now, if you reflect on that, in the first part, when Prophet ﷺ defined this religion with a'mal and deeds, what should we do? It is this aspect which created in Islam all the sciences of Sharia and Fiqh. So this enormous work in Islamic Sharia and jurisprudence, fiqh, it came because of this definition of Islam, which Prophet gave, that Islam is an activity. What does Sharia deal with? Sharia deals with this question that which human activity is acceptable and which is not. That is the realm of Sharia, which created enormous scholars of Sharia. Okay. The second question, which dealt with Iman and faith, that is which created the sciences of Aqeedah and Kalam. So we have great ulama like Abul Hasan al-Ash'ari, Imam Abu Hanifa, who was also a great scholar of Aqeedah. His great book on Aqeedah is Al-Fiqh al-Akbar. So it created the sciences of belief and Aqeedah. Because if Aqeedah is wrong, this is a very important point. Very important point. If Aqeedah is wrong and false, then Amal becomes meaningless and useless. The value of Amal is rooted in Sahih Aqeedah. If Aqeedah is false, then Amal is thrown away. It does not carry weight. Okay. And then, in the third aspect, when Prophet ﷺ simply talked about the inner state of a person, about the batin of a person, without saying what he should do and without saying what should he believe, that created the sciences of tasawwuf and wilaya. Where do awliya come from? They come from this ihsan, because they are the scholars of batin. They are ulama of inward states. If you don't know how to pray, you go to a scholar of Sharia. If you don't know how to focus on God, you go to the wali. He tells you what is wrong with your inner self. He will tell you how you can purify your batin. The scholar of law will not tell you. Okay. And therefore, sometimes you will see a hadith. Okay. A hadith which says that there is no prayer without Fatiha. La salata illa bi Fatiha til kitab. This hadith pertains to Sharia. If you did not say Fatiha in your individual prayer, then your prayer is not valid. Another hadith which says, La salata illa bi hudur al-qalb. There is no prayer if your heart is not present. That is not Sharia, this is Ihsan. This hadith deals with station of Ihsan, batin and spirituality. Okay. So if somebody says, where do these awliya come from? They come from Quran and they come from this hadith. And in Surah Fatir, there is a verse which is also on the same pattern, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that God has sent this religion. He has sent this scripture. And then it says that in this ummah, Ummah Muhammadiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who are inheritors and who are the wariseen of this deen. And it says, ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اصْطَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اصْطَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا We have made the heirs, the wariseen of this scripture, the people whom we have chosen. فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ And some of these chosen people who are the heirs, the wariseen of their book, they are very sinful. They are wrongdoers. People like us, myself, that we are sinful, we are wrong, but yet we belong to Ummah Muhammadiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. God did not exclude us from this ummah because of our sinfulness or wrongdoing. And then it says, وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ And then there are those who are pious and virtuous. They also inherit this deen. And then it says, وَمِنْهُمْ سَابِقُمْ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِسْمِ اللَّهِ. And then among them are those who exceed in virtue. With the help of God, they cross the limits of goodness, and they are the true inheritors. ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ. They are the one who are receiving God's fadl and God's bounty. So dear brothers and sisters in Islam, here ulama knew and understood that in this structure of religion, ihsan is supreme. And if ihsan is supreme, then awliya are the highest authority. The highest alim is not the alim of sharia. The highest alim is the one who is at the highest degree of ihsan, spiritual excellence, that he has achieved that. Therefore, you will see that all ulama in the history of Islam, all of them, they will go and sit in the presence of awliya. Even though when they themselves are wali, and they themselves are on a very high station, Imam Abu Hanifa, who is Imam of Sharia, who is Imam of Aqidah, who is a great muhaddis, and he is a wali, but still he will go to Bahlul Majzoom, sit in his company, and he writes Bahlul Majzoom among his shuyukh. Bahlul Majzoom did not write any book. What did he learn from Bahlul Majzoom? There is a story of Bahlul Majzoom that Harun al-Rashid and his wife, one day they were walking on the river of Furat. What was the name of his wife? The name of his wife? Anybody? Zubaydah, yes. Zubaydah. And Bahlul Majzoom was there. He was making homes with the sand on the river. And his wife says that, Bahlul, what are you doing? He says, I am making houses in the paradise. So she says, how much is that? He said, it's 10 dinar. Okay. So she gave him 10 dinar. He took it and threw it in the river. Okay. So Harun got upset that she wasted 10 dinar. What is this? Okay. So that night, when Harun slept, he saw in the dream that there is a beautiful garden and there is a wonderful palace. And the palace says that it is the palace of Zubaydah, Qasr Zubaydah. So Harun al-Rashid, he wants to enter the palace and there is a guard and he says, get out. Only Zubaydah will enter in this palace. You are not allowed. So Harun wakes up and then he thinks about what happened the day before. And he realizes that there is something there. So the next day, they go back to Bahlul Majzoom. Okay. And again he asks him that, Bahlul, what are you doing? And he says, I am making homes in paradise. So Harun says, how much is that? He says, it's 100,000 dinars. So he says, why? Yesterday you gave my wife for 10 dinar. He says, you know, yesterday's customer had iman bil ghaib. He came with iman bil ghaib. You are coming because you have seen it. Okay. So it is this Bahlul that Abu Hanifa will go, rahimahullah, and sit in his company and learn from him. You will find there are enormous stories. The same is about Imam Shafi, that he will go to Abu Hamza Sufi and Imam Shaban Rai, and he will act in front of them as a child. I don't have time to tell the stories. The same is Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, who was such a great Imam, who single-handedly stood up against Mu'tazila and took all the persecution and refused to compromise on his belief that Quran is not makhluk. He will go in the sit in the company of Bishr al-Hafi, a saint who will walk on the streets of Baghdad barefoot. And the animals will not drop their filth because of his respect. This is known miracle of Bishr al-Hafi. And sometimes the students of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, they will say, Imam, the whole world comes to you to learn from you. Why do you go to this person, this mystic, this Majnoon? Okay. And Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal says, you don't know. Ana alimun bi amrillah wa bishr huwa alimun billah. You don't know. I am the scholar of God's religion. I know God's religion, but Bishr knows God himself. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, in 1200 years of Islam, and I'm saying 1200, I'm not saying 1400, okay? Because past 200 years are the time of corruption, moral degradation, and Islamic confusion, okay? No one in the history of Islam, no alim, including Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, nobody denied Wilaya. Not a single person refused to believe that there is a Wilaya, there is a sainthood, and there are people who are God's Auliya. And they all knew these Auliya are a distinct group of people. Everybody is not Wali. Everybody is not Wali. There are some people who are Wali. Just like everybody is not Alim, there are some people who are Ulama. Who are these Auliya? Let us see what Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says about them. There is a muttafaq alayhi hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu narrates, he says, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Iza ahabba Allahu al-abda nada Jibril." That God loves someone. He falls in love with someone for whatever reason. He loves him, and when he loves him, he calls Jibril, and he says, "Oh Jibril, I love that particular person." And he says, "Oh Jibril, you should also love him." فَأَحْبِبُهُ فَيُحِبُّهُ Jibril. And Jibril alayhi salam loves that person, and then he says, "Oh Allah, what should I do?" He says, "Tell everybody in the heavens. Tell them that such and such person is God's beloved. So they should also love him." فَجُنَادِي جِبْرِيلُ فِي أَهْلِ السَّمَاءِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ فُلَانًا فَأَحِبُّهُ. He announces in the sky, in the heavens, that God loves that person. So, O angels and O arwah, you should also love him. فَيُحِبُّهُ أَهْلُ السَّمَاءِ. So the people who live in heavens, they love him. And then it says, ثُمَّ يُوْدَوْ لَهُ الْقُبُولُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Then his love is brought down on this earth. Okay? So if people love Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, and if they love Data Ganjbakhsh, and if they love Muinuddin Chishti, if they love all these awliya, they do not do that because somebody has made a big conspiracy and somebody has plotted something, or somebody is giving oil money to them. It's not. This love is alive on this earth because it is alive in the heavens. As long as they are loved by God and His angels, there will be people There will be hearts on this earth that the love of these awliya will always be present in their heart. And here you can also notice that in this hadith, the love of God comes before the love of person. This is a very important point. That God did not say, He loves me. He says, I love Him. So the love of God comes first. And that is what makes Him God's beloved in His heart. And there are hundreds of ahadiths. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrates in another Sahih al-Bukhari, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Man aada li waliyan faqad azantuhu bil harb. If one is enemy of my wali, I declare war against him. وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَزْتُ عَلَيْهِ وَمَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أَحِبُّهُ فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ كُنْتُ سَمْعُهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ وَبَصَرَهُ الَّذِي يُبْصِرُ بِهِ وَيَدَهُ الَّتِي يَبْطِشُ بِهَا وَرِجْلَهُ الَّتِي يَمْشِي بِهَا وَإِنْ سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ وَلَئِنْ اسْتَعَاذَنِي لَأُعِيذَنَّهُ. Salanti hadith. And it says that a person comes closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I love him to a point that I become his hearing with which he hears. I become his eyesight with which he sees. I become his hand with which he grabs. I become his feet with which he walks. And another hadith says that I become his heart with which he thinks. And I become his tongue with which he speaks. So when people say, how come these miracles take place through awliya? They take place because they are not awliya. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is working through them. When the hand of wali becomes the hand of God. When the tongue of wali becomes the tongue of God. When the eye of wali becomes the eye of God. We find that how awliya, such as Abdul Qadir al-Jilani and Mu'inuddin Chishti rahimahullah, that they will look at a person and the person will say shahada. Before they tell him what is Islam, how many speeches we make, how many degrees we have, and we do not succeed with our own children. And then we go and criticize these people. What kind of arrogance, what kind of kibr, has entered in our age and time and in our life. There is a hadith, again a lengthy hadith, so I'll go just to that portion. And it is narrated by many sahaba, including Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, says that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after prayer, he stood up and he says that, listen to me carefully. Isma'u waqilu wa'am. Listen, understand. Now, Sahaba will always listen carefully. But if Prophet is making them attentive, meaning he is telling something extraordinary. And then he tells them that, listen, there are people, they are not prophets, and they are not martyrs. Laysu bi anbiya wala shuhada. But on the day of judgment, they will be sitting in God's qurb, His nearness and proximity, that even Anbiya and Shuhada will become jealous. They will envy. Okay? Now, not because Anbiya are always superior, but they will be surprised that why this person is there. They know I am here because I am Nabi, but what this person is here, why he is here? And he will say that they will be surprised. And an Arabi says, O Prophet, tell us who these people are. Define, describe, visualize us. Okay? And Sahaba, they will always look for an Arabi. Because out of respect, they will not ask questions. So sometimes when Arabi comes, a Badu comes, he doesn't have much restriction, so he will ask. So they will be happy that he is asking questions. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam pleased for surra wajhu Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam liswal al-Ahrabi when he asked this question. And Prophet said, "Hum nasum min afna'in nas wa nawazi' al-qabail lam tasil baynahum arhamun mutaqaribatun tahabu fillahi wa tasafu." That these are the people from different tribes and different parts, and they are coming together not because they have any relationship or they have any business, but they are coming together simply because they love God. Tahabbu fillah wa tasafu, and they are pure. From that comes Sufi and Safa, purity. Yada'u Allahu lahum yawm al-qiyamati manabira min nur. And the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will place the members of Noor for them to sit. فَيَجْعَلُ وُجُوهَهُمْ نُورًا وَثِيَابَهُمْ نُورًا. And their faces will be radiant with Noor, and their dresses will be Noor. يَفْزَعُ النَّاسُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَلَا يَفْزَعُونَ. Every day, everyone on that day of Qiyamah will be fearful, afraid, but these are the people, they will not worry. And then he recited, "Hum awliya illahi allazeena la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun." Remember, these are God's awliya, and they are the one whom God has saved from the calamities of this day. How many minutes I can go?
4 minutes.
Okay, I'll finish in 4 minutes, inshallah. So here, the love of Wali is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why we love Auliya? Because God said, "I love them." Okay? God does not pray. He does not fast. He doesn't go to Hajj. But there are two acts which God says, "I do." He loves His Auliya, and He sends blessings on His Prophet. So we Ahle Sunnah are also obsessed with these two things. Okay. We are focused on these two things because these are the two things which are Sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to visit, now to love a Wali is the Sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To visit a Wali is the Sunnah of Anbiya and Sunnah of Sahaba. I don't have time, but you know the story of Surah Kahf, where Hazrat Musa alayhi salam is asked to go and visit Khidr alayhi salam, who is a Wali. So a Nabi is superior to Wali, but Nabi is asked to go so that it should become the Sunnah of Anbiya. Because if Wali comes and visits the Nabi, that is not Sunnah. This is the way it should be. Okay? So he becomes, so, and you know the story, which is also very interesting, that how Khidr tells Hazrat Musa alayhi salam the mysteries of acts which are not known. Also you see in the hadith that where Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam commands Hazrat Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhu that you should go and visit Uwais Qarni, who is a Tabi'i. He is not a Sahabi. Sahabi is superior to the Tabi'i. Okay? But Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam commands them to go so that it should become the Sunnah of Sahaba to visit the Awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Umar radiallahu anhu visited. And he says that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked me, he told this to Uwais Qarni, that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked me that I should seek my forgiveness through you. And Uwais Qarni says, you are Prophet Sahabi. Your status is higher than mine. You are the one that I should seek your recommendation. And but Hazrat Umar says that no, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told me that Uwais is a person that when he asks God, God does not refuse. This is what Prophet told me. لو أقسم على الله لأبر. So Prophet is saying that here is a God's wali who did not meet me, but his status is so high, so exalted, that if he will ask God, God will answer his prayer. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, quickly, there is an hadith where a person, where malaika, they go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and report that, O God, we found your people worshipping you, glorifying you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks many questions, and at the end he says, go and forgive all of them. And when angel says that, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but there was one person, he really did not come to worship you. He was just passing by, he was doing for some work, but he just saw these people, so he also sat for a few minutes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, forgive him too, because anyone who sits with these people, he cannot be without forgiveness. La yashqa jaleesuhum. La yashqa jaleesuhum. In ahadith shafa, there are many, many ahadith that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, told to Sahaba, you don't know what bargaining is. Okay? That when you fight and you argue with each other, or you buy something and you argue with each other, you don't know what it is. You will know when Auliya will bargain for their murideen on the day of judgment. And when God will send them to paradise, they will refuse to go. And they will say, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these are our friends. They prayed with us. They fasted with us. We will not go to paradise without them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, go, and anyone whom you know, take him out of hell and put him in the paradise. Yeah? So what is the benefit of knowing a wali? This is the benefit. This is the benefit. When amal take you to hell, where did your amal take you? To hell. Where did wali take you? To paradise. So if somebody says, there is no benefit of visiting Auliya, okay? There is no need for that. Here is the need. Here is the need. And this is called silsila. Silsila means chain. And there are many ahadith where Prophet ﷺ says, because they will make a chain and they will not enter until all of those who loved them, they also enter paradise. So dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the concept of wilaya and the presence of Auliya is not something which Sufis invented or which Ahl Sunnah have fabricated. This is something which is authentically present in the text of Quran Kareem, in the authentic hadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there is ijma and consensus of all ulama of this ummah throughout history until this modern age of corruption and confusion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to the right path, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to those people who are loved by him. So if we are not good, and we are not good because of their generosity and because of their sadaqah, we are also counted among the good and pious people. أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين إنه تعالى جواد كريم ملك بر ورؤوف رحيم وصلى الله على النبي.
Allah
Akbar. Ya Rasulullah. Ya Rasulullah.